your mouth.
My mom and Ramon would tell him to scream help, you know, I'm hearing it.
Ramon would stuff hot peppers into those poor children's mouth to make them stop crying.
I thought it was wrong.
Oh, the baby's gonna go. Just Marina, get in here.
Hey, I'm dizzy.
What, Mama? What?
Coach,
what? I've had enough with this, Mama.
Her mother had expressed to her to take care of that baby.
Alan, who do you think you are? Girl,
you you gotta on. Think of something, baby.
What are we gonna tell?
Hurry up!
She pulled out her cart.
Okay, shopping cart. We'll tell him she fell out of the shopping cart.
Translator's out sick. Can't find one damn person around here to speak Spanish.
Great. We don't speak a lick. What the hell are we supposed to do then?
No digas nada. Se esto a estos niños no sabe hablar español. Dile que no entiende. Not mine. Sorry, no inglés.
These here diamond earrings. They were from Greg's room. You were trying to steal these, and he walked in on you, and you killed him. Bang.
They don't understand a word you're saying.
Manuel, no podemos seguir mintiendo. Tenemos que decirle la verdad.
No.
Pero ese pleito estaba a un lado del cuarto. Diles.
No, porque ellos van a saber que nosotros robamos la gente.
Yo ya sé que has estado robándole a la gente, bruto. Entonces dime de la discusión. Al menos que quieras ir a la corte por asesinato, idiota.
Pendejo!
It's perhaps one of the biggest things Tennessee is known for, entertainment. But some fear the business is going elsewhere.
We're losing so many movies, so much entertainment, so much money. And people think, oh, it's not going to affect us. We're country music. No, these award shows are moving. You got Georgia taking our shows. And it's Memphis Beat. And I had to travel to Louisiana, down to New Orleans, to film the show.
Carter, the insurance company seems to know something I don't.
Is it a secret? I was hurt in a wreck, and now the insurance company is pressuring me to sign their release.
Welcome to Crystal. Enjoy your crispy onion crystals.
But what if you don't win?
Then you don't pay.
Just like that?
Just like that.
I want my no-fee guarantee.
Take a look at the photos you've taken recently. If you can't tell if you're in Annapolis or Atsugi, chances are you need to get off your installation.
Check this out.
And go explore. After all, you've got a wonderful opportunity living overseas. Take advantage of it. Explore the land and culture that's just outside your door. Visit your MWR travel office for more information.
I'm joking, man. I found it. I found it. I found the key, the missing puzzle. Look, just grab three other guys, call them up. You know who to call.
This guy just came out of nowhere, just wanted to take a bite out of me. And God, I think this is where we're going to. Man,
it's too much trouble. It's not like the Gideon police will come after you. See, now that's worth the extra effort. A Gideon Expressions card is worth that little extra effort. Change of life.
Hey guys, thank you for coming. This is the Lounge Network, and we are on the Indie Lounge. And today I have a special guest. His name is Santiago Cirilo, and I'm going to introduce him right now. He's going to tell us all the type of projects that he's been doing. And you probably may not recognize him initially, but if you're a big fan of The Walking Dead, you'd be like, oh, that's him. So let's introduce you now. Hello, Santiago. Thank you very much for joining us.
Hey, Carlos. Thank you for having me, man. It's an honor and pleasure, brother.
So we've been talking for a little bit of time for the past few weeks trying to set up this interview and, you know, looking up your background. I know you're from Puerto Rico and that you've been doing quite a few projects. You're going to be doing a few films of your own. And but right now, your big thing that people may recognize you in is, in fact, The Walking Dead.
Yes.
But we're going to get into that in a moment. But first, and I keep pressing the wrong button. I do apologize for that. This is live, folks. This is how we shoot. I wanted to get into, you know, here you are, you're getting into these projects, but this all started from somewhere. And, you know, like in most of my interviews, I like to get into the nitty gritty and find out who you are, where you came from. So let's start with where you were born.
Let's do it. I was born in Fajardo, Puerto Rico in 1973 and family moved to the United States when I was young. At age five, since age five, I was raised up in Ohio, in Lorain, Ohio, big Spanish community up there. It's about 20 miles from Cleveland. And, you know, just continued my education, went to Columbus, Ohio, and pretty much it was a weird story. I lost all my money goofing around, lost my scholarships and stuff goofing around, and thinking where I wanted to do. I was sitting at a bench, and here comes this Army recruiter, and next thing you know, I was flying overseas in the Army Infantry. And make a long story short, man, I ended up in Nashville, Tennessee, the new birth of entertainment, and started looking around, started getting involved in the entertainment business. One big influence was when I got out of the military, I got to do guitars for Gibson Guitar here in Nashville. And with the military mentality, man, it was like I was there to clock in, to clock out. And we were supposed to do certain amount of guitars within a week. I was doing them, you know, making the numbers within a day. And moved up the ladder, man. Next thing you know, I was doing the guitars personally for Kid Rock, Aerosmith, you name it, man, all the music stars, Keith Urban and so forth, and kind of gave me the entertainment bug, man, and just, you know, took a prayer about it. I always entertained people, and it led me to some great agents and started auditioning, man, and it just took off from there. It's unreal.
That's awesome. So now, so they would come to you? I mean, how does that work? Did they go to Gibson and they say, I want a custom guitar?
Yeah, you know, the name brand sells.
Right, of course.
And with having an artist, let's say Kid Rock's in town, and he likes his white Les Pauls, gold trim. And sure enough, they'll make, even though they have one on the shops and the stores, they customize it, make it for Kid Rock. It doesn't have to even have his name. It just has like a tape where it tells you who's it going to. And we'll build it right then and there. We'll have it painted. We'll have it, you know, me soldering it up, tuning it, putting everything. I mean, I just get a naked guitar, a piece of wood, painted with Kid Rock's name on it. And I just put it together, tune it up, finalize it. It goes to a final tuning, and it gets shipped out.
Wow. That's pretty wild. And yeah, so, man, I guess you were taught all this stuff.
Yeah, man. I never played guitar. Never.
So even now you don't play guitar?
I do. I have an acoustic guitar. I do have an acoustic. And Gibson is one reason why I play guitar, man. I fell in love, of course, with country music out here.
Okay.
Man, it's just something weird, man, because you go to Gibson and me as somebody that's just new to Nashville, man, everybody in Gibson Guitar is an artist, man. They all play guitars. Think about it. They take a break sometimes in the middle of working, and in the middle of the day or some kind, all of a sudden you hear one playing AC/DC. Then another one kicks in and starts playing Star Wars, John Williams, and they all get in. Next thing you know, you got a bass player, you got a guy jamming on the Les Paul, wow. Another guy on the SG and Flying V, and it sounds like a band.
So this sounds like a setup that should have made you a musician more than getting into films and stuff.
Yeah, man. But ever since I was a kid, man, I entertained clowns. Not clowns, crowds. But I was a class clown.
Okay.
Let me fix that out. I was a class clown in school, man. I've always, not to want attention, it was pretty much I was a very poor guy growing up, kid. And one of the part to keep me happy was always entertainment, you know, keep the jokes, the cracking jokes away from you and more concentrate on people. Oh, that guy, that's Santiago. They call me Cirilo over there by my last name. He's a funny guy. You know, stuff like that. But I'm always in love with entertaining, man. And one thing is you get me in front of a camera and poof, there I go.
So where was your first exposure outside of the guitar stuff?
Right. I got an agent in Nashville, and they were like, hey, you want to make $50? I was like, all right, you know, be an extra. I didn't know extras stay on the set for like 15 hours. You know? I didn't know that. I thought it was like, you know, half a day and they get paid. But I did this. I was infatuated. I was just so going after the producer, the guy behind the camera, the director. You know, I didn't care about the main actors. And I just got in touch with them. And, you know, it was $50, but I wanted to know the business. And sure enough, man, that same producer that I did $50 for hires me a lot now.
And, that's cool.
You know, bigger price, but you know, that's the kind of influence that I have towards people when I meet them. You know, I want to know about you and what you do and try to adapt and grow with it.
Now, speaking of that, I have interviewed one other Latin actor, Robert Mondesino, who is right now he's actually going to be in a TV show that is releasing on Amazon. And clearly right now, saying things like Amazon and Netflix and a couple of these new entertainment networks, I'll call them.
Yes.
The scene is changing for entertainment. Anyway, that being said, as a Latino, have you felt any of this categorization, stereotyping, that type of stuff? Do you feel anything like that has occurred?
Man, it's always there. That's one thing about the acting business. If you don't want to be stereotyped, if you don't want to be looked at different, then you don't need to be in this business. Mm-hmm. One thing that I do carry, I mean, I played a lot of villains in TV shows, you know, from the jewel thief to the, you know, even the murderer, big murderer kind of deal. But there's certain things that if it certainly stereotypes that person, you know, like really hard, I kind of take a second look at it. And, you know, I'm not that in that position yet to make that kind of decisions. You know, I'm like, man, right. I got to get paid and I got to, you know, but yeah, I'm very happy to see a lot of Latinos, you know, from, you know, like Chicago PD and other great shows that I watch and so forth, you know, that they're cops, they're less villains, you know, and they're superheroes and less, you know, villains. And it doesn't hardcore stereotype of being the gang member or stuff like that. So, you know, I enjoy it, and I see the growth of it. You know, there's over 80% of the viewers in the world from TV show to movies are Latinos. You know,
right.
And you have to get that. You know, think about it. Every time, like the Zorro movies, half of the Zorro movies are, but they give a big fan base. You know, so okay. Yeah, man, I'm very happy for it, and I see it growing, especially with Netflix and Hulu, and even YouTube are turning into a network, and they're reaching and grabbing and hugging these independent filmmakers, which turn out to be a lot of our a lot of minorities.
Yeah, that's true. In fact, most of that is what I seem to cover. All my interviews are with independent filmmakers and musicians and so on. Now, describe to me, outside of the extra work, when you got into your first big thing or your biggest project.
You know, it's funny. The first biggest project was playing on a special of America's Most Wanted. I played the lead villain on it.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And it was a good story. It was to capture these criminals that abused children and also animals. And I did this, my first big gig. I was global everywhere. I got paid like maybe $1,100 for it out in Mississippi. And every week when the show was back on Fox, and I think it moved to Lifetime or something, man, I was getting hits on it. It was like, I got paid $1,100 for the show. I ended up making $10,000 for the show total. Wow. Almost. And they just caught the criminals like last year. And this was since 2009. I don't know. I'm not sure.
So I didn't realize that they would give you residuals.
Yeah, when it's on a major network, yeah. And then when the major networks gets bought off to their sister network, you know, it still goes. But the difference is, from the major networks, you have a steady line of paycheck for a while. With a sister cable network, it goes down real fast. And then, you know, to
so
the
it's
point
a little bit like record labels. A little bit like record labels, where the music plays in radio stations and then in streaming and so on. So each one has its own little pay structure. Now, in the middle of all of this, we were talking earlier, and you mentioned doing voiceovers and stuff.
Yeah.
So describe that a little bit.
Man, I did a lot of voiceovers for commercials, Spanish, English, radio, TV, even internet ads for pop-up ads and so forth. And it's really, you know, voiceovers is so comfortable. I can see why actors fall in love with it, because you go to work in your pajamas, man. You literally, you know, example is I met Michael Rosenbaum, who played Lex Luthor in Smallville. And he, if people don't know, he is a the voice of a lot of DC animation, especially The Flash. And
oh, really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, man. And I met him, and it was Michael Rosenbaum with hair and everything on break, you know, and he's talking about working on the studio, you know. And it's kind of different, you know. Of course, as you do voiceovers, whether you're always selling something. You're always selling that product, you know, you're selling the Flash, or you're selling that advertisement. Mm-hmm. Compared to acting, you're trying to more deliver the storyline and get involved with the story plot.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah, I was, in fact, speaking of the Flash, I just watched the Flash yesterday.
Great show!
Yeah, and did you see the one with Mark Hamill?
Yes, that's what I watched yesterday, my super DVR.
Yeah, what's funny is, and I don't know if you know the background, but the father of the Flash,
yes,
was the original Flash in the TV show, and yes, then the Trickster, who is Mark Hamill, played the Trickster in the original Flash TV show also.
That's true.
So it's like it was a little reunion.
And he also, Mark Hamill's the voice of the Joker.
Joker, yep.
And he had a little Joker kind of.
He also, I think, did Wing Commander. Which was an old video game when video games first started, but we're going way back into our age.
Yeah.
So, all right. How many years have you been working on being inside the entertainment industry as an actor?
7 years, man. It took off that fast. You know, okay. I have friends that have been in the industry in L.A. for 30 years or more, and I have more credits than them. I mean, I'm not trying to brag on it, but it's literally a blessing, man. I was at the point where, as you know, in the business of in everything you do, it's business first. And the business of the incentives, the film tax incentives, hit Georgia and it hit Louisiana and it hit the Carolinas. And now everybody was filming in the South. So instead of me going to L.A., which I did for 2 months, you know, I started finding more work in the South, man, from driving 5 to 8 hours and making hit films, hit TV shows, major global ads, you know, even modeling ads and stuff like that. I mean, it was a blessing, man, and I caught it just in time.
So you're now the Papi Chulo.
The Papi Chulo, yeah. Huh? Something like that, right?
All right, so now let's lead into the Walking Dead. How'd that come? You know, I mean, you're in Georgia, so it's a given. Sonoy is like a hop, skip, and a jump from where I am. I'm in Noonan.
Right, right.
So how did that come about?
I have a agent out in Atlanta, and what happened was that at this time, I was already credited. You know, I had USA Network, TNT, Lifetime, and other TV shows and major appearances and so forth. And I was actually on my way to Louisville to film a miniseries for Fox. And my agent calls me and flips out. And all I remember the show is Andrew Lincoln shooting a zombie. That's all I remember from season one trailer. And they were about to start the fourth season or during the fourth season. And I was driving to Louisville doing the show, ready to do the show. And my agent calls having a heart attack. And I'm going, what's wrong? You know, what's going on? She's like, you're on The Walking Dead. You're on The Walking Dead. And I'm going, it was like one of them moments. Everything just got quiet. And I'm going, isn't that zombie show? She goes, you're an idiot. Pull over. Where are you at? So it's kind of that story. I got the little taste of the info on it. I didn't know how big it was. Wow. I didn't know all the main characters, how big they were. I was going to work, man. That's literally what I was doing, living in my car to driving here. And I mean, long story short, man, it took off like crazy. You know, it was very secretive. It was bouncing here and there, different storylines. While they're filming, man, they're changing your stuff, man. And, you know, they tell me to be quiet. I try to be quiet. Next thing you know, they launch the mid-season finale poster all over the world. And there's me, you know, the main cast, you know. And it took off from there, man. And then, you know, I was happy to be cast in 2 episodes of it. And there's more to come about it, but hopefully it goes through. But all I got is from my resume and my headshot. I didn't audition for it at all.
So tell us a little bit your character in the show.
I am the last survivor of Woodbury. I had the flu I don't want to spoil it too much. Some people haven't watched season 4, believe it or not. But I had the flu and survived the flu and joined the main cast to take out the governor or fight the governor in a major attack in season 4. And from there, it just, you know, progressed more, you could say.
I won't get into that. I will say, and anybody who does watch the show, there are, and I'm not going to spoil anything, but there are characters that have been as early as season 1, some season 2, that are not in the show and then all of a sudden are back. So I'll leave it at that. So
good man.
And so, you know, I wish you much luck with the show, because I'm a big fan personally, and as I'm sure a lot of our viewers are. Now, a few weeks ago, I had an interview with Sexton Creations.
Yes, Kevin, yes.
So Kevin was an awesome character. He brought the South back into my show. And he's doing a lot of interesting things. So give us a little bit of information about that, because I know you guys are maybe working on a project or have been working on a project together. Give us a little bit of background on that.
Yeah, I met with the Walking Dead popularity. I've been so honored to be touring a lot of the United States during comic conventions and meeting the fans. And one convention I met was Kevin Sexton. He's an independent artist. When I say artist, man, this guy does clay models, crafting, paintings, drawings. He's a filmmaker, writer, director, producer. I mean, I can go on and on. Yeah. He is one of them great souls that has that needs that opportunity to be found, to at least be looked at. Mm. And I believe his product and his projects and everything he does is a definitely a win-win situation for anybody who would like to invest in it or be part of it. And he asked me, you know, and to be part of his films. And sure enough, next thing you know, we did a little good agreement. I mean, I went out there and helped them do 2 films. I was honored to be part of the cast. You know, the cast and crew made me look good, man. I was just following his lead. And I play a evil vampire king named Dread Drake, who will be in 2 of his films, Paranormal Chasers.
So, yeah, we did talk a little bit about the character. He's got an interesting face. Can you explain a little bit of that?
Yeah, it's pretty much latex, man. He gives a old school barbarian mixed with that old fashioned Dracula look, and it's kind of weird how to say it, but you know, I have the long nails, I have the green eyes, the long barbarian hair, you know, the old armor kind of deal, and a throne that's, you know, old school. And it's one part of the film, and the other film, you know, it's a different look for me. I can't release too much.
Yeah, I hear you.
But yeah, it shows you the 2 sides, more like a old school and a modern vampire switch. Mm. And Dread Drake is pure evil. I mean, Kevin does a lot of family films, and keeps all the cuss words and all that stuff, tries to make it enjoyable for everybody and so forth. But when he put Dread Drake on there, I don't think you expect what he wrote in the character in mind, because I was killing everybody.
Yeah, he spoke very highly of you. So now what's next? What are you working on next?
I'm doing a TV show. We did a pilot, but it's hopefully we'll turn into 13 episodes out in North Carolina, Charlotte, North Carolina, called The Nephilim Chronicles, which is goes back to the story of the Nephilims, which is the half-angels, half-human breed that fallen angels supposedly made out with humans and made this breed. And I play more like a detective that investigates the paranormal, come to find out I'm fighting and killing and hunting creatures and monsters from hell that we know from today and from yesterday and some new ones. Mm. And it is pretty good, man. I have this birthmark that's alive, and it gives me these powers, and we're doing it out there with 13th Floor FX out in Charlotte, North Carolina, and Single Cell Productions. And, you know, hopefully it goes good. It's been pitched out to Sci-Fi, Chiller, and a lot of cable networks, and we just got the green light to redo the whole pilot and a few episodes. Wow. So,
well, that sounds awesome.
It's really good. Netflix wants it bad, so, I mean.
Oh, really?
Yeah, especially with these new angel shows, like CW's doing a similar show. Not similar, but it's about angels that are protecting the world and getting ready for, you know, the Armageddon. That's
right. Well, yeah, there's a number of them. Like, there was a comic book called Constantine.
Yeah, Constantine's doing good, too, on ABC, I believe.
Right, so that was a movie that eventually got picked up as a TV show.
Correct.
That is based after the movie occurred. And then there's, there was Legion, the movie. There is the sci-fi movie, sci-fi TV show, and I can't remember the name of that one. But
I can't remember that one. That one's really, I think they attacked that with a Dark Knight kind of aspect.
Yeah. Basically, it's after, I don't know if it was after an apocalypse, but something devastating happens to the world, and they kind of create this little multi-class world of angels. Not of angels, but humans. And then the angels come down and.
Right, actually, that was in season. They only had one season. I'm not sure if they got picked up for another season.
Yeah, that's a shame, because it was starting to get interesting, and it had the Archangel Michael.
Yeah. What I saw of it, I think I saw.
Oh, wait, know what it was? It was the movie Legion.
Yeah,
it was the after movie of Legion.
Was it?
Yeah.
Well,
It's all based on this show. So the girl who had the child.
Right.
In Legion, the child grows up and he becomes the leader of this world, you know, unbeknownst to him. And the archangel that protected him in Legion is the character, is not the same actor, but it's the character is protecting this man now.
Hmm.
And so on. And but the bad guy is still the bad guy, and demons and all that.
The bad guy.
Yeah. So, well, that's cool. That's awesome. And now you're also doing, I believe is it a documentary, or you have
I'm doing that, and I just finished a movie called Old Chicago Souls, like 1920 gangster film. We're doing some in black and white, some in color. It's a mixture of both. It's going to be released sometime next year on Netflix. I just finished that, and we went old school. I mean, we even got the great grandson of Al Capone to be involved in it. So it was a great, 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 great grandson, you could say, or something like that. And he looks just like Al Capone. It's just amazing.
Wow.
But I've done that, and I just got time to, I wrote a story. I was in the military. I was in the 101st Airborne in the infantry at 3502nd in Fort Campbell, Kentucky. And one of my best friends and military brother was part of my team. And we pretty much, you know, after the military, we stayed in touch. We visited each other and so forth. And we bonded so close. And in 2010, he took his own life. He was battling a deep depression. And it was a hard time for me. Because at the same time, you know, after that happened, 2 weeks later, I lost my mom to cancer. Mm. And I pretty much shunned the world away from me. And when I gathered myself together, I wrote a story. And it's called A Veteran's Homecoming. A friend of mine named Tom Vigneri, that worked a lot in a lot of networks, affiliated networks in Kentucky, and his wife, Goldie, who has worked with a lot of films and written a lot of great stories, including she was even involved with WWE and involved in the Macho Man, oh yeah, who's in the Hall of Fame. I'm a big wrestling fan. Anyway, she wrote some of his storylines. And anyway, they helped me write this story and made it a good film script. And we are going to release a crowdfunding event on Veterans Day. And what we're going to do is we're going to film this in a small town and small community to not just help the community and help the small businesses, but we're hiring all veterans first within supporting cast to crew. We're also dedicating the movie to veterans, and we're donating 20% of the film earnings will go to Wounded Warrior Project. Along with that, we want to show the movie before selected theaters. We want to show the movie to veterans, retirement homes, VA hospitals, veteran organizations, and military posts all around the world to show our not just our active military, our veterans, but also Americans and us supporters that, you know, it's hard. You know, we come back from a different world. You know, and we come home, expect to come home, and the adaption and the help to adapt back into the civilian life is not there. It's there through family. It's there through commercials. It's there through, you know, Patriot holidays where we buy our shirts, we throw fireworks in the air, and we hug and throw ribbons on our trees. But what percentage or what do we actually do to help our veterans? And I'll give you a real answer to that. Nothing. Mm. And I say this because we have 21 veterans committing suicide a day. 21 a day. And we have a lot of commercials, advertisement, and, you know, Veterans Day car sales and everything. What about the veterans? What about my brothers, my sisters? You know, it doesn't matter just because I was in the infantry that, you know, there's also veterans that did support, you know, in other military organizations, Army, Navy, Marines, Air Force, Coast Guard, you know, National Guard, males, females, you know, and we don't do nothing. We just make money off of it. So this is what I want to do. And I ask, I've been plugging this a lot. You know, I've shook hands with homeless people. I shook hands with rich people. I've been given a lot of closed doors in my face because I want to do this project because there's not enough money into going back into the investors. So I'm doing this crowdfunding. And I added to that crowdfunding, I will post every receipt possible to show that that money is going where it needs to go. I'm not just going to ask money. I'm not going to ask a famous star for a prom date. I'm not going to, you know, do all these crazy things to get that attention. I'm literally delivering a message to America. I'm a veteran, and I'm asking for your help. And we have a Facebook site. We're selling T-shirts on the site. We're just trying to have people to like the page, you know, get about 10,000 likes. So when I do launch this, it can go all over the world, you know, and hopefully get funded. And we're just requesting $70,000 to $200,000 to make this film. Mm. Of course, the more we make, the more it goes global. So I hope people do that, you know, and it'll start a network because I've written 7 films, and each film that I do will go back. The next film I'll do will be a Bitter Man, Story of Simon, and that. Same deal, but it'll be a different organization, which I'm planning to give 20% of film earnings to that, to St. Jude's. And it just keeps going, man. And right. I think we make a lot of money on these films. You know, you got Marvel and DC and all these sci-fi and all these movies making hundreds of millions of dollars to billions of dollars. man. And yeah, they might donate stuff here and there that we don't hear about, but there's certain things that we need to express more to bring out to the top of the line that especially helps saving lives. And the lives I'm talking about are people who protect our lives and our borders, you know, and never gets that appreciation. And I believe veterans, our military veterans, needs to be that top-notch person or people to be notarized and recognized.
Well, one, I wanted to express thank you very much for your serving. And it's great to hear that you're looking to devise a way of giving back, especially to your brothers and sisters, like you mentioned, in the military. And I hope you guys watching, you know, I'm going to put the link on the end of the show as well, so that you can check out the Facebook page and then follow the project. Let's bring it to a close. Is there anything else you want to be able to share or something that you want to mention in respect to who you are and what you want to do with yourself?
I just want to thank everybody that's been, you know, that knows me personally, I grew up with, and the new fans that I'm constantly meeting, man. I get fan mail from Switzerland, from Germany, you know, all over the world, and the support and the love that they express, because they know, yeah, I was on The Walking Dead, but I also doing this, and they're continue to support me and making me grow in this industry. And I want to thank that, man, the people out there, you know, that really make us, you know, I'm an actor looking for work, and the fans get me that work with all the how do you say, advertisement that they give, support Santiago, you know, help Santiago in this film or these projects, check out Santiago in this new commercial and so forth. That stuff helps a lot, man. You know, social media is growing, you know, cable and Dish Network is dying. The only thing that's keeping them alive is DVRs, and we're getting the love from the independent world now that supports independent projects. You know, so it doesn't have to be just me, but it has to be independent, you know, support them people. You know, before Walmart was Walmart, it was just Sam's Corner Store. And there's a lot of Sam Corner Stores around that need your help, you know, whether it's in TV, music, clothing, videos, or whatever, man. Just support them small people, you know, like Sexton Creations and other people as yourself, Carlos, you know, in this wonderful broadcast.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. All right, so I'm going to give you one last question, and this is a big one, so I want you to be prepared for it.
Here we go.
Are you ready? Is the hat staying on the head? Okay, good.
Here we go.
All right. What's with Superman?
Superman. I am a big Superman fan, and it's nothing to do with the superhero, believe it or not.
Oh, really? Okay.
That's a little twist. My mom was my rock. She introduced me to God. She raised 7 children, 6 boys and 1 girl in a 2-bedroom apartment, a duplex. My dad was a major alcoholic and very abusive, you know. He turned his life around the last 5 years of his life and actually became my father. But we had a lot of hand-me-downs, man. I used to wear baseball cleats to school, you know. I used to wear, you know, clothes that didn't fit me, get laughed at, you know, and so forth. But my mom was always there working, man, working, going to, she slept in a couch so us could have a bedroom to sleep in. And one thing, when her Christmas bonus, out of all things, man, she gave us underoos, but back in the 80s was popular, and we never had anything popular. And the underoos that I got was Superman. My brother had the Flash, and we shared it. You know, we shared the shirts. I wore them everywhere, man, to school. People were laughing at me. Oh, you're wearing pajamas to school, you know. And I carry that. So I carry that symbol. My mom passed away, but I still have that ambition, that drive, that Superman spirit, you know, that my mom put in me. Heck, I got my name written in Kryptonian in my arm.
Wow.
You know, but that's what I have, you know, and that's the whole reason of Superman. And I keep that, you know. Superman is everything. My mom was everything. She defeated everything possible, even though she died battling cancer, but she survived, you know, survived in expressing that love that she has. She opened the doors to homeless people and fed them. We used to come home from school, and there was a homeless guy there eating, You know, she gave clothes. She opened the doors to fed people in the neighborhood. Those are the old Latino, you know, kind of things that she had, you know, and that's the spirit I have. That's what I express. That's why I want to do films, want to do entertainment world, want to get back. You know, I want to throw a big concert and give all the money to that small town. You know, don't want to give money to that small town because they had a flood or anything. I want to give it to that small town because they need help. I don't want to give it to that small town because a tornado just hit it. I want to give it to that small town because this is what they need. You know, it's that kind of deal. I don't want to wait till disaster happens to help people. We need to always help, help, help. And that's what I want to do, man. I'm not here to be famous. Mm-hmm. I'm just here to help people, man.
Well, it's awesome that, you know, the way you're honoring your mom. It's very touching.
Thank you, brother. Thank you, man. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Okay. Santiago, so from here, I want to be able to share with everyone how people can follow you and where they can, you know, basically stay on top of what you're doing and the project you're working on and stuff like that. So where can they find you?
Man, social media, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, Google, you name it, man. I'm trying right now to, I'm working it all myself. So it's me you talk to. It's no, you know, assistant or anything. You know, right now I'm trying to battle it out. I'm blessed to be, you know, having that time to interact with fans. So it took me up in social media. If you see a word called Haya, it's my warrior cry. It means never give up. Follow your dreams. If you receive a lot of no's, swallow it with pride because a big yes is coming. You know, live life. Don't ever give up. It's a reason why we are blessed. We have that special gift. If you want to live a normal life, live a normal life. But if you want that gift to explode and show the world what it's really made for, hi-ya. All right? I appreciate it, man.
All right. Well, I appreciate you. You know, I'm going to be following you. I'm going to make sure that I promote your projects. Everybody who is following me, you can follow me on Facebook with Carlos Phoenix. You can follow The Lounge Network at The Lounge Magazine on Facebook. And on The Lounge Magazine, you'll be able to follow all the people that I interview. I post a lot of what projects they're working on, all that type of stuff. And I'll be doing the same thing with Santiago. And listen, good luck with the projects that you're working on, the films, the TV shows, the whole nine yards, and many blessings to you.
Thank you, man. Thank you for the great opportunity, Carlos. I appreciate it, brother.
Thank you very much for coming to the show. And for all of you, this is The Lounge Network and the Indie Lounge, where we basically get to meet and become fans with the people that I interview. And I have other shows like The Artist Alley, where known directors and filmmakers and illustrators and artists from the comic book industry and beyond. So follow the shows, theloungenetwork.com. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
Hi-ya!
Great. We don't speak a lick. What the hell are we supposed to do then?
No digas nada. Esto a estos niños no sabe hablar español. Dile que no entiende. Not mine. This, not mine. Sorry, no inglés.
These here diamond earrings, they were from Greg's room. You were trying to steal these, and he walked in on you, and you killed him. Bang.
They don't understand a word you're saying.
Manuel, no podemos seguir mintiendo. Tenemos que decirle la verdad.
No.
Pero ese pleito estaba a un lado del cuarto. Diles.
No, porque ellos van a saber que nosotros robamos la gente.
Yo ya sé que has estado robándole a la gente, bruto. Entonces dime de la discusión. Al menos que quieras ir a la corte por asesinato, idiota.
Pendejo.